My wife traumatically ripped the blankets off me last night, but I will recover. Today, I'm going to recap a 1999 action thriller film called The Boondock Saints. In the opening of the movie, we are introduced to siblings Connor and Murphy, two devout Irishmen with their own family prayer. Early on, they go to church on St. Patrick's Day, where the priest discusses a young girl who was brutally murdered in the streets while bystanders did nothing. He views this apathy as a greater evil than the actual killing. The brothers take in his message and leave. Connor and Murphy work at a meatpacking factory and are generally harmless unless provoked. They enjoy fighting for a cause, but are otherwise good-natured individuals, well-liked by their neighbors and friends. Doc, the bar owner, is also supportive of them, but brings troubling news one day. He tells them that the Russian mafia is expanding its influence in the area and plans to close down his bar. Doc has one more week on his lease, but on St. Patrick's Day, three thugs arrive to evict him. One of the Russians, Ivan, instructs Rocco to stay while the others leave. The protagonist brothers attempt to resolve the issue peacefully, but the Russian mobster won't even hear them out. The following day, police find the bodies of the gangsters near Doc's bar. FBI Special Agent Paul Smecker arrives to examine the case and hears Detective Greenlee's shocking theory. Excitedly, Greenlee presents his hypothesis, suggesting a larger black man was the culprit, but Smecker isn't convinced. He sends Greenlee for coffee, and within minutes, Smecker, like a true investigator, develops his own theory. He determines that one thug was hit by a toilet and the other suffered a broken back. Additionally, he locates the apartment where the toilet was removed, the brother's home. He also uncovers the weapons and calculates that two shots were fired. Smecker believes the crime was not gang-related but personal. The officers visit the brother's apartment and confirm the missing toilet. Greenlee is shocked but continues to insist that a huge man attacked the thugs. Smecker, however, disagrees and ridicules him. Concurrently, the brothers are in the hospital, battered, and considering turning themselves in. Doc visits and tells them that Smecker is investigating the thugs' deaths. The brothers aren't afraid and want to explain that they acted in self-defense. They give Doc the money and weapons they discovered and ask him to hold onto them while they're hospitalized. At the police station, Smecker is furious with his colleagues for leaking the case to a journalist. The entire town now knows about the thugs' deaths and views the brothers as heroes. Nevertheless, Smecker emphasizes the need to apprehend them. During this time, the brothers arrive at the police station, appearing like the walking dead. Smecker decides to interrogate them privately, informing them that he recorded the entire incident. The brothers consent to tell the truth but refrain from discussing the guns and money. The scene then transitions to the bar, where henchman Ivan orders everyone except Rocco to leave. Rocco, heavily intoxicated, insults Ivan and receives a punch to the face. Consequently, the two brothers and their friends start fighting the henchmen. They tie one of them to a table, set his rear end on fire, and throw the two bodies into the street. The following morning, the two henchmen enter the brothers' apartment intending to kill them. Their injuries are bandaged, implying that the brothers tended to their wounds after the fight. Ivan apologizes to Connor and says he will kill him after killing his brother. As Murphy is taken away, Connor grows furious, grabs the toilet from the floor, goes to the roof, and hurls it at Ivan's head. He then jumps on the other henchman to save Murphy. Connor strikes Ivan's head twice, steals the money and guns, and takes Connor to the hospital. Smecker concludes that the brothers acted in self-defense and decides to release them, but they request to remain in the cell until the reporters outside the station disperse. An officer tells the reporters that the brothers are innocent and will be released soon. That night, both brothers have a vision compelling them to cleanse the city of the filth harming good people's lives. They resolve to wage war and eliminate all the criminals in the city. In the morning, the brothers receive a message on the phone they took from Ivan. They prepare to leave the police station and find that all the newspapers are discussing them. Connor, who speaks Russian, calls the number from Ivan's phone and learns the location of a criminal's meeting that evening. In the subsequent scene, we learn that Rocco is a runner for the Italian mafia family and works for the boss, Papa Joe. They are aware that Rocco was present during the confrontation with the Russian mafia. Now, he sits before Papa Joe, trying not to soil himself as the boss is in a foul mood. Papa Joe asks Rocco to make him laugh, and Rocco tells a joke. Papa Joe erupts in laughter and consistently refers to Rocco as funny man. Before visiting the Russian mob boss, Connor and Murphy sell the henchmen's jewelry and guns to purchase weapons. Connor insists they bring a rope, as it is customary in spy movies. Murphy initially considers it a foolish idea, but eventually agrees. After visiting the mobster, Agent Smecker is summoned to the crime scene. Upon arrival, he discovers a true massacre has taken place. Analyzing the addresses, Smecker deduces that two gunmen killed 9 criminals and placed coins with religious significance on the victims' eyes. In the following scene, we see the events unfold. The brothers crawl through the ventilation shaft to reach the room where the mobster is located. At one point, they start arguing over the rope and become entangled in it. Consequently, they create a hole in the attic and fall. Fortunately, the rope catches them, and they start shooting all the criminals around them. After eliminating all the henchmen, the brothers force the mob boss to kneel, recite a prayer, and shoot him in the head. They then spot a briefcase in the room and find money inside. At some point, they hear someone knocking at the door. They open it, throw the man to the floor, and threaten to kill him. They soon recognize it's Rocco, who says Papa Joe sent him to kill the 9 Russians with only 6 bullets. Rocco struggles to accept the reality of the situation, as his friends have just killed numerous people and frightened him. The scene shifts to Smecker, who believes the massacre is the result of a mafia gang war. The brothers then visit Rocco's house and inform him of their plan to save humanity from criminals. They get drunk and smoke. Rocco plays with a gun and accidentally kills his girlfriend's cat. In the morning, Rocco and Connor take a walk outside. Connor tells Rocco that his boss likely sent him to kill a Russian mobster just to be killed himself. Initially, Rocco doesn't want to believe it, but the two brothers try to convince him that Papa Joe has betrayed him. After arguing for some time, Rocco exclaims that he is leaving to confront Papa Joe. A few hours later, Rocco returns to the apartment, urgently insisting that they have to leave. Rocco discloses that he went to Papa Joe's bar and discovered that everyone already knew he was supposed to be killed. In a fit of rage, Rocco kills everyone in the bar. In the following scene, we see how it all unfolded. Rocco enters the bar, kills 2 goons and the bartender who works for Papa Joe. After calming down a bit, Rocco suggests targeting Vincenzo, Papa Joe's right-hand man. One night, the trio follows Vincenzo to a strip club. As Vincenzo strangles a dancer, the 3 saints kill him. Officer Smecker follows their trail, but his theory that there were only 2 of them is disproven when a club employee reports seeing 3 people shooting. 2 unrelated street criminals are also killed in the strip club, debunking Smecker's mob war theory. The agent then learns about the murders in Papa Joe's bar and becomes utterly perplexed. The one commonality among all the murders is the victims' lifestyles, as they were all bad people. Frustrated, Smecker grows infuriated as he cannot identify the culprit and leaves. Papa Joe, realizing he is being targeted, decides to hire the most formidable hitman he knows. The man has no name, only a number, and has been imprisoned for years. In criminal circles, he is known as Il Duce. Papa Joe asserts that they must stop Rocco before he either turns the entire crime family over to the police or kills them all. Subsequently, Duce is released from prison. Rocco tells the brothers about a hitman they must eliminate in the name of goodness. This ruthless hitman kills anyone he can get his hands on. Rocco learns where and when he plays poker and plans to break into his house and kill everyone there. The brothers agree and arrive at the hitman's house in a minivan. As the trio sneaks into the criminal's house, Officer Smecker reconstructs the events. The trio enters the house and starts shooting everyone inside. In the midst of it all, it is revealed that the ruthless hitman is actually Vincent Vega, who happens to be in the bathroom at the most critical moment. Later, the hitman emerges and attacks Rocco. The two brothers leave Rocco to confront the hitman alone as he seeks revenge. They toss Rocco a golf ball, which he uses to kill the hitman. As the trio exits the house, they encounter the hitman known as Il Duce, who fires all his guns at them but fails to kill them. Rocco is injured and loses a finger, but luckily, they all survive. When Smecker arrives at the crime scene, he despairs as he cannot determine the identities of those responsible for the killings of the city's criminals. Then he discovers Rocco's finger and is relieved, realizing that he can now find the culprits. The trio watches the news and learns that Smecker plans to continue the investigation. Rocco proposes killing him, but the brothers refuse because he is a good man. That evening, Smecker inputs the finger into the database and an image forms in his mind. He realizes that the lead brothers have decided to rid the city of criminals with Rocco's assistance. Smecker must choose between arresting the brothers, ending their crusade, or turning a blind eye to their actions. On one hand, he feels that Connor and Murphy are doing the right thing, but he cannot accept that, so Smecker goes to a gay bar near the church and gets drunk. In the morning, when the brothers go to the church, Rocco sees Smecker and follows him. Smecker wants to confess, but Rocco intends to kill him. Connor stops him and instructs the priest to ask certain questions. Soon, Connor realizes that Smecker is on their side. Eventually, the agent promises to help the brothers and leaves. Upon exiting the church, the brothers call him for assistance. Smecker must now locate the enigmatic mercenary Il Duce, but he learns of a more pressing matter. The trio is heading to Papa Joe's house to kill them. Knowing that the house is full of henchmen, Smecker goes to help them. During the attempt, the trio is captured as they try to break into the house. They are brutally beaten and tied to chairs. Later, Papa Joe kills Rocco, leaving the brothers in shock. Meanwhile, Smecker arrives at Papa Joe's house disguised as a woman. He seduces a guard, lures him to the bathroom, and kills him with a blow to the head. Afterward, he exits the bathroom and kills another henchman. At that moment, the brothers free themselves, and when a henchman enters, they kill him. Connor and Murphy then decide to give their friend a proper send-off and recite a prayer. In the process, Il Duce enters the house and strikes Smecker in the head, rendering him unconscious. When Il Duce hears the brothers' family prayer, he lowers his weapons and joins them. It is revealed that Il Duce is their long-lost father, as only he and the brothers know the prayer. Consequently, they decide to join forces to rid the city of evildoers. 3 months later, Papa Joe is put on trial, and although there appears to be enough evidence to convict him, reporters on the scene predict his acquittal. The trial is dramatically halted, however, when the two brothers and Il Duce, aided by Officer Smecker and some police officers, burst in and interrupt the proceedings. The three openly declare their mission to eradicate evil and recite their prayer one final time before shooting Papa Joe in the back of the head with several bullets. The trio is dubbed saints by the media, and the film concludes with a series of Man on the Street interviews in which various Boston residents debate whether the saints are ultimately a force for good or evil. If you enjoyed this video, don't be shy to hit the like button, and if you disliked it, hit the dislike button twice, just to be sure. It would be best if you watched the whole movie. Thank you very much for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this.